What's happening, y'all? In this video, we're going to talk about flowcharts as a tool we can use to help us write better code. A flowchart is a visual representation of the different steps we use to solve a problem. Let's jump right in and see what we're talking about by analyzing our quadratic equation solver. Remember, we had MATLAB code that was designed to do this in 9 lines, 2 of which were blanks. Point was that we stored all 3 variables as A, B, and C. Then we use the quadratic formula to find the left and right roots of our quadratic equation. This particular set of code was done in MATLAB syntax. In other words, it's written with lines that MATLAB is designed to understand. We could use a verbal description of that syntax in something that's called an algorithm. So when we're trying to analyze what this code does, syntax gives us the actual solution in MATLAB. The algorithm statement allows us to put that into simple, understandable English so that we're not stuck in any particular programming language, but instead we're abstracting to the general ideas that we're using. One of the issues with algorithm statements is it's not always easy to visualize how the program flows from one statement to the next. In this case, because this is a sequential program control, it goes from step 1 to step 2 to step 3, it's a little bit easier, but later as we get more sophisticated, we're actually going to be jumping back and forth between steps, and we also be branching. Sometimes we'll do one step if one statement is true, and a different step if that statement ends out to be false. That's called a branching statement, all of which are examples of control flow. The point of a flow chart diagram is to allow us to understand how the sequence of steps progresses, given that we might have different conditions. We're starting our introduction in flowcharts with a simple program to get our head around how this tool works. And then we're going to slowly introduce more sophisticated examples and become more fluent using flowcharts. Let's get started with this discussion by going to a good online resource. To do so, we're going to go to any web browser and type in flowchart tutorial. Then we're going to look for the result that is by visual-paradigm.com/tutorials/flowchart-tutorial. That has some really good information about how flowchart work. Notice the first line states that a flowchart is simply a graphical representation of the steps in an algorithm. We show sequentially how the algorithm flows from one step to the next. It also gives us some examples of different symbols that have special meaning when we create flowcharts. So one symbol, which I love the name of, is called the Terminator symbol. I feel like Arnold Schwarzenegger should get involved here. It's just a small oval, and that represents either the start or the end point of the algorithm. So using a small circle, we say start the algorithm here. When we're done processing all the data that we need and we're at the output that we desire, we have a small circle to say end this process. A box represents some particular operation. For our particular algorithm that produces solutions to the quadratic equation, we only need 3 symbols: a terminator symbol, a process symbol, and also a direction arrow or a flow arrow. These are lines with a little arrowhead on one side that represent the flow of the sequence of steps and the direction that those processes happen within our algorithm. So in other words, when we're processing the algorithm to solve quadratic equations, we're going to start our algorithm at the top, run sequentially from step 1, step 2, step 3, connected with arrows, all the way to the end, and then we're going to terminate our algorithms, which means we need an oval at the top, small process boxes for each of the steps in our algorithm, and then an oval at the bottom, all connected with single arrows, since this algorithm progresses sequentially, step by step, from the start to the end. In order to create such a diagram, we can use many different software packages. My favorite for this purpose is something called draw.io. It's a free online flowchart maker. It allows us to link with our Google Drive, OneDrive, a device on our computer, GitHub, Dropbox, etc. I don't really want to make that decision at this moment. I'm just going to say decide later. Once I've clicked the decide later box, I get into the general online platform to save diagrams. In this case, I'm going to call this the quadratic solution algorithm flowchart. And then I want to save this as a .png file. I kind of like that one. and we'll rename it. So now look, I have a quadratic solution algorithm flowchart.png. I can also save this on my computer. So if I go up to the file and go down to save as, I can save on my local device, and that actually downloads a file onto my hard drive. Notice if I go into the downloads, the most recent version of this is my algorithm flowchart, and I have done nothing, so this PNG is blank. But in other words, I have that saved on my local device. Now that we've learned how to title and save our file, let's go ahead and start drawing. So in this case, remember, we're gonna do this terminate oval. When I click on that item, draw.io automatically places an oval on my sheet. In this situation, if I go up to file and down to page setup, this tells me the type of paper size I'm saving to here. Notice this is set for an 8.5 by 11 inch paper. I have many, many different options. If I'm going to do this for a YouTube video, I could do it by 16:9 ratio. I could do it by 4:3. I can also do different sizes. In this case, I'm going to save 8:11 because I want to print this out. I'm also going to do it in portrait mode, not landscape mode. I can change the grid sizes by just increasing or decreasing. I can also change the background. In this case, I'm kind of happy with both of those. Let's go ahead and apply. The reason that this is useful is I now know that the width of this paper is 8.5 and the length is 11 inches. When I click and drag this particular oval around, these automatic guiding lines kind of show up, and this gives me a sense of where the exact middle of my paper is. So when I do this, I can kind of place it, and then I can change the size of this by just clicking and dragging. I'm going to go ahead and delete that and restart because I kind of like the look of this. Let's move this down to the middle of the page, and we'll do so by kind of aligning the edges of this with the boxes there. Now I can double click on that, and that gets me to text, and I can actually write start here. I can highlight that text by just going ahead and double clicking on it. Over here, notice that I can do different styles, so I can do heading or normal. In this case, I'm just gonna do normal. I can also change the font. For me, I like Times New Roman, so I'm gonna choose that. And then I'm gonna change the size of it. Let's go up to size 24. If I can center left or right, depending on what I'd like to do, I can boldface, just like any word processing document. Now that I have my start circle or oval outlined, let's add a box or a process box. Remember, the first thing that I wanna do is input the values of A, B, and C. In this case, I'm gonna go ahead and do a process box a little bit lower. Right in the center, notice that it kind of aligns equally. Draw.io gives me these kind of guiding lines that allow me to see when the two features are lined up. Once I have those aligned, I'm going to double click, and then I'm going to type in store A equal 3. I can then double click on that text to get to the formatting. Again, I'm using Times New Roman. We'll go up to size 24 by just clicking on that, and that gives me my first step of the algorithm. Notice if I click on the start ellipse and then click down on that little arrow, draw.io will automatically connect the start ellipse to the first process, which is to store my variable A, and draw an arrow from the one before to the one below. I can delete that arrow by simply clicking on it and pressing delete. If I were to click on the second box and hit the up arrow, this would connect this box to my ellipse in the upward direction, which is exactly what we see here. I can also change the style and format of the line. Notice I can kind of delete the arrowheads or create a double arrow. I can also change the width of the line by increasing the point size. In this case, I want a normal one arrow, which is exactly what we have. Let's click on this, delete it, go down. We'll go ahead and do this maybe 3-point so we can see it. We can change the color of this if we'd like by choosing any color that we want. I don't really like blue in this case, so I'm going to go back to black. Another thing I can do is actually add text to this. So if I just click on the text button under the general diagrams, I can actually say line one. Let's go ahead and highlight that. We'll go down to Times New Roman. We'll make this a little smaller. Instead of 24, we'll make it 16. And then what we'll do is increase the box size and then drag this over to the center of the store to represent this particular step happens in line one of my code. We've done enough work here that it's probably painful if we've lost it. So let's go back to save as. I'm going to save on my device. Notice draw.io automatically downloads this into my download folder. The saved file name is the same title that I gave to my file earlier, except this time it has parentheses one to represent it's the second time that I've saved this. I think you now have enough information to actually leverage this program to make a full diagram. I'm going to do that off screen and then show you the results as an invitation to try this for yourself. All right, I've just finished about 30 minutes of work on this. I want to show you how I can access that. So I'm going to go down to File and I'm going to say Open From. In this case, I'm going to open from my device. Here, I've actually retitled my flowchart to have the same name as the code that I wrote. That's kind of a useful trick that I can use to associate the flowchart with the MATLAB code that I've produced. I did 17 different saves on this. This is my most recent one. If I double click on that PNG and open, draw.io is gonna import that. Here it's asking me if I wanna open it in a new window or in this window. I'm gonna open it in this window. Here I have the entire algorithm that I've produced in a step-by-step form. I can zoom out a little bit so I can see the whole thing. Notice I start, I write or I save A equal 3, I write or I save B equal 1, I save C equal negative 3 in memory. Then I do a number of calculations. First, I calculate the value of the left-hand side, and then I write that variable into X1. Next, in line 6 of my code, I calculate the value of the quadratic function at my stored root, and then I save that as variable check 1. Do the same thing in line 8 and line 9, and then I end. All of these steps flow sequentially from the start to the end of my program, and I've captured that. Over here, I'm simply aligning each particular process with the corresponding line of code in my MATLAB script file. Once I have this, of course, I can save it, which is what you saw earlier. I just go down here and I save as. If I save on my device, I can automatically download it. I can also print this. So if I go ahead and down to print and preview, this gives me a preview of what it looks like. And then I can go ahead and push control print on my operating system. Let's open in Mac preview, which is just a PDF operator. Notice that gives me a nice flowchart that represents visually what's happening in my algorithm and captures some of the ideas behind the code. We'll get more practice making flowcharts with draw.io as we get more sophisticated in our programming problems. The point of this particular video is to show the code that we produce often has many ideas behind it. One way to represent those ideas is by an algorithmic statement in simple English. I like to call that a verbal description of what we're doing. Helps me get my head around how I'm attempting to solve the problem. Sometimes I want to visualize how my sequence of steps is going to move from one step to the next. To do that, I use a flowchart. Here we're using draw.io to produce this. We've only seen two different types of steps, starting slash ending a particular process or doing one step in each process using a box. We connect those writing the sequence of arrows from start to finish. This is called the sequential flow because we go from one step to the next. We process each line individually. Once we're done doing that, we move right down to the line under it. There is no changes, there's no jumps, there's no repeats, there's no branches. This is just a simple sequential flow structure. With that, we now have some tools to write, analyze, and implement algorithms to solve problems in scientific computation. That's exactly what we're gonna do in future videos. I'll see you there.